Earlier in the gospel passage, Jesus is walking towards Jerusalem on his way to Jerusalem with his apostles behind him. He says that the Son of Man must be handed over, and the Son of Man must suffer, and they will put the Son of Man to death, and on 3 days the Son of Man will rise. As soon as Jesus says those words, Peter gets in front of Jesus. Peter grabs a hold of Jesus. And Peter says, "Far be it, Lord, that I should ever let that happen to you." And Jesus looks him into the eyes. And just before this event, just before Jesus announces his passion for the first time, and just before Peter grabs a hold of him and says, "You know, far be it, Lord, that I should ever let that happen to you," Jesus just changed Simon's name to Peter, which means rock, and on this rock he will build his church. And now, Jesus looks at the rock when he's going to build his church, and he says, "Get behind me, Satan." He calls Peter Satan. For you think not as God does, but as man does. Before we criticize Peter, at least in my own life, in my own reflection, I get it. I get why St. Peter would do that. In fact, if I was in his shoes, I probably would have done the very same thing. Because don't we have a hard time watching others that we love suffer? Do we not from time to time say to ourselves, "I wish it was me that was suffering like this and not them"? We say that. We have a hard time dealing with it. And so that event of Jesus' announcement of his passion for the first time, what immediately follows is today's gospel, the Transfiguration. And just like last week, where we had the temptation of Jesus in the desert, what preceded the temptation was baptism. And I said that the baptism and the temptation have to be read together, side by side. Because in the baptism, the voice of God from heaven says, "This is my beloved Son, with whom I am well pleased." And then in the temptation, what does Satan say to Jesus? He says, "You are the Son of God. Turn these stones to loaves of bread." Those two passages are related by sonship. And now in today's gospel passage, Jesus announces his passion for the first time, and the Transfiguration should be read side by side. Because everything that Jesus does in this gospel passage is predicated on the fact that Peter will not allow the Son of God to suffer for him. And so now, instead of Peter grabbing hold of Jesus, it's Jesus who now takes Peter, James, and John. He grabs hold of Peter. And it's Jesus who once again is leading them where? Up the mountain. This is what we saw a couple weeks ago on the summit of the mountain. Whenever someone in Scripture goes up to the mountain, it's because they're going to receive some sort of divine revelation. Boy, do Peter, James, and John receive a divine revelation. What they are seeing is the glory of God and his fullness. The humanity of Jesus, humanity itself, is now having the glory of the divinity shine upon it. It's an uncreated light that is overwhelming Peter, James, and John, the overwhelming light of God. Overwhelming. But yet the humanity of Jesus is absorbed, it's not destroyed, it's illuminated by divine light. And so much so that it's not just an event for Jesus, it's an event for every one of us, our weak and frail bodies that we have, with all the aches and pains, will be glorified by the living. It's all our paths, it's the path we are destined to go to, but the path to get there is the way of the cross. And that's hard to take. Peter couldn't accept it. We don't want to accept it. I guarantee you, 9 times out of 10, all the sins that we commit, 9 times out of 10, it's because we're trying to avoid some sort of suffering. God almost guarantee it. We don't want to suffer. Because we need to say, well, in a way it is perfect people, but we want to avoid it. We've got to understand this mystery. I can't say much about this, but in this mystery of transfiguration, what God has revealed to us is that in the path of human misery and human suffering, that the glory of God is still there. You know, in fact, in 5 weeks, especially the moment we read the Gospel of John and John's hashtag, we're going to see that the glory of God is that crucifixion of Jesus. That's how John puts it. Not in his resurrection. The glory of God is what the manifestation of the deep love of God for all humanity is manifested at the cross in this body that Jesus takes on. It's laid down as an offering for our sins. And it's all motivated by pure divine love. We have a hard time letting people love us like that. We can't accept the fact that people will sacrifice and die for us. Hard to take. We have to see go through that. But God is willing to do it. And maybe there are people in your lives that won't do that for you. But can we accept and embrace it? Because Peter did it. This is why Jesus saw, this is why Jesus gave him this event of transfiguration. The strength in Peter's faith. Again, it's hard to describe how in this mystery the cross and the glory of God have come together. How our human suffering is a mystery and God's glory, how they side by side in our lives. I can only give you an illustration. Back when I was in seminary, I had an assignment in the Lehigh Valley in the Spanish parish. And this nice, sweet Spanish lady came in and started to teach me Spanish. She'd do it once a week, and she used to be a teacher when she was younger. I didn't know at the time that she had cancer. She was doing this while she was sick. Eventually, towards the end of my summer assignment, she was hospitalized and probably on her way to hospice. I went to see her to give her strength and hope and courage. Boy, was I mistaken. When I sat down with her, when I talked with her, just the amount of faith and how there was no fear in her life, and her sense of joy and peace in the midst of her suffering. She had this deep love for God, and she knew that God was going to take care of her. I didn't strengthen her. Her faith in the midst of suffering strengthened me and encouraged me and motivated me to continue on my path through the seminary. But it was because God's glory was in the midst of this pain and suffering that she had through her great faith. In the very last lines of Transfiguration, it says that this is my beloved son, listen to him. We have to listen, but more importantly, we have to trust in God always. All of our pains and struggles in life, know that God's glory is there, and that in the end, when things are all said and done, He is going to glorify our lives with His uncreated light. The path.